Imagine holding a 10-pound weight above your head. For many people, that's pretty easy. Now, hold that weight for 2 minutes. Still possible, but more challenging. All right, now hold that for 15 minutes. An hour, 2 hours. Over time, even a small amount of weight grows unbearable. Your muscles need rest and recovery. Similarly, when we're learning, our brains can only handle so much information before needing a break. Dr. John Sweller coined the term cognitive load to describe the amount of information working memory can hold in the moment. This is why you find yourself tuning out a lecture about an hour into it. It's also why you tend to forget most of the information when you cram for a test, why you struggle with certain confusing diagrams, and why you might have a hard time with long, complicated verbal directions. Cognitive load theory builds on Atkinson and SHIFFRIN'S model of information processing theory. Here's how it works. We all experience incoming information through our sensory memory. Think of this as anything we see, touch, hear, smell, and taste in the moment. Sensory memory is instantaneous, and much of it is forgotten. But some of the information moves to working memory. Working memory is what we are thinking in the moment. Here, the information is either forgotten or moved into long-term memory through a process called encoding, where the brain categorizes the information. We can help ensure the information moves from working memory to long-term memory through a rehearsal process. If you've ever repeated a phone number over and over again to remember it, or you've paraphrased information, or you've put events into a sequence, then you've engaged in this rehearsal process. Later, your working memory can retrieve information from long-term memory back into the working memory. More recently, Dr. Barbara Oakley, co-author of Uncommon Sense Teaching, has introduced an approach based on cognitive science to reduce cognitive load through retrieval practice. So how can we as educators reduce cognitive load? Number one, break up the instruction to give students a chance to process the information at an individual and collaborative level. You might do something like a think, pair, share, where students summarize what they learned or answer a critical thinking question. Or students might jot down any question they have or write down something that they're confused about. They might pause to fill out a graphic organizer like a table or a flowchart. When learning a new concept, students could add to a concept map, summarize a key idea in a 1-minute summary, complete a Venn diagram, or brainstorm examples of that concept. When learning a new skill, you can break tasks down into parts. Here, students view a step in the process and then practice it individually. Afterwards, they move to the next step and practice that step. Then it continues for the remaining steps. Number two, engage in brain breaks. In fitness, athletes often engage in interval training where they do intense focused exercise followed by a period of short rest and then focused exercise again. Similarly, students will retain more information if they have focused learning followed by short bursts of rest called brain breaks, where the brain can consolidate the information and make connections between ideas while students rest. Brain breaks might include a short walk, a fun game, a coordinated physical movement, or a quick divergent thinking challenge. Number three, we can design our instructional materials to reduce the split attention effect. The split attention effect occurs when students must divide their attention between two sources of information, like a diagram and a text. So when you do provide a diagram, place the text on the diagram itself instead of below or beside the diagram. When giving directions, combine written and audio instructions, and break the instructions into bullet points or numbered lists. You might also use templates with clear visuals to create a sense of predictability. When working on projects, you might use a general blueprint or a to-do list that students can use as they track their progress along the journey. Number four, embrace active learning. Now, this doesn't mean that students have to be moving around the whole time. The key is to be mentally active. As Freeman in 2014 put it, active learning engages students in the process of learning through activities and discussions in class, as opposed to passively listening to an expert. This active learning often involves critical thinking questions, peer interaction, visualization techniques, and opportunities to apply the knowledge that they're learning to case studies, problems, and projects. As educators, we can reduce cognitive load by implementing these simple strategies. Over time, these small tweaks can make a huge difference in the lifelong learning of our students.